Joining us now, Joe Sitt, he is the CEO of Thor Equities, a major real estate firm here in New York, responsible for a lot of projects around the city. And Joe, you say that the trade war with China will be deeper and more prolonged than a lot of people realize.
You know, you always get the wild card in the Trump administration and their abilities to do deals in spite of some of the challenges. We've seen the accomplishments, first led by his son-in-law, Jared Kushner, with the first reach out on North Korea. And then we've seen his administration take over, and we even see the activities in the most recent days, which have worked out well. And we've seen Jared do an excellent job in NAFTA, but he's a little bit distracted trying to make peace in the Middle East. And right now, the rhetoric building up in China is actually scary. My personal view is it's deeper than people think. I think that the Chinese military-industrial complex has come out of the closet, and now people are starting to crystallize that we've really got a hemispheric battle, challenge, war, so to speak. You got the dragon on one side, the eagle on the other. And I think whether it's business or military, everything is going to start falling under those two. And you see companies like Facebook and WhatsApp on one side doing their deals in the West. And then you see companies like Tencent and Alibaba doing deals in Russia and places that are within their sphere. And then from the military side, that's the thing nobody talks about, the dirty little secret. It's getting a little scary. You know, we had a little run-in about a month ago by Subic Reef and Mischief Reef. And then you see Australia and India getting all nervous, about to spend more in military weapons than they've ever spent in the history of those nations, just because they're afraid of what falls when they fall under the China hemisphere.
These things didn't happen overnight, though, right? They've been building up for quite a long time. I mean, you create an island, and then you militarize an island. You know, I mean, it was like 6 years ago, I can recall a top official in the Philippines asking Japan, of all nations, and people understand the history of Philippines and Japan, to rearm themselves to push back against the imperialistic threats of China. So these aren't necessarily new developments. Do you think it was time that someone stepped in from our side to A, point it out, and B, to try to slow it down?
I think it's so well said what you said. They did it so wisely, the Chinese. Just very quiet, hidden in the back of the room, acted like they were the poor little country in the corner, still getting certain UN help as if they were a developing country. And I think the world suddenly woke up. You know, those original islands, I don't know if you remember way back when the first sensitivity came up, the commitment was they would not be armed. Now all of a sudden you see them being armed. And if you see what that does along the South China Sea, how close it is to the Philippine border, the Indonesian border, and then leading right there over Brunei into Australia. You know, that's very important military strategic positioning that they took.
Well,
and scary.
China has claimed this area for a long time. Even the islands, a lot of islands that already exist there, have been under dispute with several countries. And one of the things, apparently, is that they believe there's a tremendous amount of oil beneath the surface there, and they want to own all of that. Japan, what role should Japan, should they ditch their pacifist constitution in your mind then and maybe play a more active role? Because you already talked about Australia and India rearming or spending more on military.
I think more the fear, if I was the country to be afraid, I know it sounds a little crazy, is more in regard to what you just said in oil. China's a growing population, tremendous amount of people, and they're very much long-term thinkers. The leaders of those countries don't just think about themselves, they think about their grandchildren, their great-great-grandchildren. The country I think that needs to fear the most is Australia. As crazy as it sounds, I could see in 100 or 150 years from today, China saying, well, look at that country. They've got good land, got great natural resources. They've got metals, cattle, everything we could use. They don't have much population. It's not fair. That's the country to annex.
Here's the interesting thing, though. They may be able to annex it through the Belt and Road program, right? Because you've got a Belt and Road program that now we're starting to understand what's going on. It was portrayed as an altruistic reverse Marco Polo kind of thing that would help connect the world. Now we're learning after Malaysia turns down $22 billion. Whoever heard of anyone turning down $22 billion? The guy, 93 years old, in Beijing, tells China no. This is a new form of colonialism. Pakistan turns down $14 billion. I mean, this is how they're taking over the world, isn't it?
Another wise, wise observation. That was a quiet way for them to do what you said, but do it in a little bit different way than I think you're thinking. I think they're not looking at it that they're colonizing those countries. They're looking at it back again, the dragon eagle battle for two halves of the hemispheres of the world. And they're utilizing that as their way into the door. Bigger than those countries you mentioned, like Malaysia, I think, is countries all along Africa. If you take a look at what's going on in terms of their economic activity there, and where are they picking more tendency to go, more political countries, politically sensitive, I should say, and all the more countries that have the natural resources that China views themselves as going to need in 50 and 100 years from today.
Joe, we got to leave it there. Thank you very much. We could talk about this stuff all day long, and it is a serious threat and needs to be talked about more. We appreciate it.